Hush a vocal, hush and listen, and his cheeks were all aglow. I bear orders from the captain, get you ready quick and soon, for the pikes must be together at the rising of the moon. At the rising of the moon, at the rising of the moon, for the pikes must be together at the rising of the moon. And come tell me, Sean O'Farrell, where the gathering is to be.
Well, in classical music, they refer to it as a violin. In traditional and folk music, they tend to refer to it as a fiddle. Since you've experienced in both, in your own words, would you define any kind of difference at all?
No, there used to be a tendency for classical musicians to call it a violin and trad players to call it a fiddle, but it's one and the same instrument. There might be a slight difference in the curvature of the bridge or the setup or the height of the fingerboard and that kind of thing to suit an individual musician, but but basically it's the same instrument. But there's a kind of almost a kind of an anti-snobbery thing now has crept in, where classical musicians seem to take it to light on referring to it as a fiddle.
Rebels. Rebels.
Yeah, rebels.
So Luke is back in the band. Bobby has left for America, I assume, and you're in the Dubliners now. I mean, is Ronnie Drew, Luke Kelly, Ciarán Bourke, Barney McKenna, and yourself?
Yeah,
I heard that Barney was quite an eccentric humorist.
Barney had a most amazing turn of phrase at times. He had his own way of describing things, and he kind of distorted the English language in a way that James Joyce would have been proud of, I think, you know. And I can give you a couple of examples. We were, first time we went to Australia on tour, it was 1968. We were met at the airport by a friend of Barney's from Donnycarney. And Barney says to him, God, it's very hot over here. I don't know if I'm going to stick this heat. And his friend said, Barney, this is early in the morning. Wait till lunchtime. It's going to be 100 degrees in the shade. And Barney said, 100 degrees in the shade. He said, Jesus, I'm going to stay out of the shade. He had a great kind of sensitivity and feeling for animals and birds and nature in general. And I gave him a lift home one night. And he inveigled me in for a cup of tea. I wanted to get home myself. He wasn't able to drive anymore. His eyesight was failing. And anyway, he hands me a mandolin and he said, teach me the second half of that tune I was learning off from you today. So the two of us had two mandolins out and we were playing. The next thing I heard this twittering and whistling of birds and feathers flapping, and realized he'd built a bird sanctuary into the kitchen, all these cages hanging from the ceiling. And I said, Barney, that's terrible. It's 2 o'clock in the morning. We're after waking up those unfortunate birds. And he says to me, don't take any notes of them. Sure, they wouldn't even know what day of the week it was. You know, you can see a special kind of a nature there.
Absolutely. And you and Barney were pretty much, I guess, the more instrumental side of the band. But Barney had a bit of a heart melter with "I Wish I Had Someone to Love Me."
That love song. That used to go down amazing. Even in places like Germany, 3,000-seater halls, and they just adored everything Barney did. But he had a way of putting a certain feeling into a song. You couldn't describe him as a great singer, but what he had, he used very effectively and put feeling in where anything else might be lacking, you know.
Well, essentially it boils down to communication, doesn't it?
Yeah, it does, absolutely. Yeah. He was a great character. I miss Barney. Think about him nearly every day or something you said or did, you know.
Fly out over the sea, I fly to the arms of my true love and bring her home safely to me. Well, I wish I had someone to love me, someone to call me her own, someone to sleep with me nightly, I'm weary of sleeping alone. Oh, I wish I had someone to love me, someone to call me her own.
And one more example for you. We were doing a gig in the concert hall. Not the full band, it was just Barney, myself, and a guitar player friend of ours, Michael Howard, that I recorded with a number of times. But anyway, we're doing this. We'd done some charity shows for this particular promoter before this. And anyway, we're called onto the stage, announced, and big round of applause. And on the way over to the mic, Barney leans over to me and he says, by the way, John, is this another charity show or is it feasible?
They'd laugh, they'd wink, and they'd nod as he passed. Oh, but this silly guard had his eye on one lass. But this little collie, she been a diehard, soon made it quite clear that she wanted no God.
Tiddly-i-dum, tiddly-i-dum, tiddly-i-dum-dum-day.
One time while on duty on a dark winter's night, he caught her out sighting without any light. "Where's your light, miss?" said he. "For an answer," said she, "it's next to me, liver, where you'll never be."
Diddly-i-dum, diddly-i-dum, diddly-i-dum-dum-day. Diddly-i-dum, diddly-i-dum, diddly-i-dum-dum-day.
Not bad.
In your book of poetry, Fiddle Dreams, you have one there about Barney and his plectrum. Have you got it handy?
Yeah, I heard him giving a lesson to a young boy, a banjo player, one day, and he was describing the pressure to put on the plectrum. And he says to him, take the plectrum like a little bird. If you squeeze it too tightly, it'll choke. And if you don't squeeze it tightly enough, it'll fly away. You know, so, and he was saying somewhere in between those two extremes, that's the pressure you need. So I use that for the opening of this poem. Barney, there's a reference to Barney fishing. He was a fisherman at heart. He had a little trawler out in Houghton, County Dublin. And that was his delight to be off fishing. He gave out to me one time for taking too many gigs. And he says to me, I want to have 2 months free in August to go fishing. If you think of the logic in that. So here it is, Banjo Barney. Your plectrum, a fledgling bird. Squeeze too tightly, it chokes. Too lightly, it flies away. Cozy in your care, it nests between finger and thumb, heeding your touch to wake wonders on string. Dancing fingers paint pictures in air. Barneyisms embellish the crack, and your love song steals the limelight. In tune with yourself, jigging for mackerel, wind song in the rigging, rhythm of rolling wave. Heave and haul of shanty, audience lashed with salty foam. You on the quarter deck guide us round the dreaded horn. Without fuss or warning, you heed a whispered call. Adrift in the doldrums, you succumb to the long sleep. Your hands fixed in death, your fledgling bird now flown. Your cap tilted to the North Star, your sails rigged for the far horizon. Heave away, haul away, sail away to the music of silence.
I really love that line, jigging for mackerel.
Jigging for mackerel, yeah. With the musical connotation, it's nice too, isn't it?
Yeah. Absolutely, yeah. So Barney had a handful of songs that he sang. Did you not fancy yourself as much of a singer at all, no?
No, I could sing and tune all right, but I reckon I didn't have a great quality in my voice, and I was very shy as a young person, and just never got around to singing. I'd say be happy enough singing in harmony all right, or singing on choruses, you know. But I could give you another example of just came into my head. There was a Shannon singer called Sean O'Connor. 007, they used to call him, Sean Connors. And he was from Connemara. And he was a brilliant Shannon singer, but we're at a wedding one day and everybody was doing the turn and Sean was asked to sing a song. And he was about halfway through the first verse when I realized he was singing in English. I'd never heard him singing in English before. And listened a bit closer and I realized he was singing a pop song of the day. But he was singing it in the Shannon style, the only style he knew, and it transformed the thing completely. The song was called Glendora, and the original song went, I'm in love with a girl named Glendora. She walks in the window of a big department store. Eyes are blue, hair is gold, she'll always be young and she'll never grow old. Oh, Glendora, I want to see more of you. But when Sean sang it, it sounded like, I'm in love with a girl named Glendora. She works in the window of a big department store. Eyes are blue, hair is gold. She'll always be young and she'll never grow old. Oh, Glendora, I want to see more of you. Total transformation.
I'm in love with a dolly named Glendora. She works in the window of a big department store. Eyes of blue, hair like gold. Never been young, but she'll never get old. Oh, Glendora, I want to see more of you. Oh, Glendora. Oh, Glendora. Oh, Glendora, I want to see more of you.
That's brilliant. But again, it goes to show the common ground that's behind these apparent genres, you know?
I know. And he didn't realize what he was doing. It was almost like a part of an art form. He didn't realize what he was, how good a thing it was or what he was really doing. But he only knew one way of singing, and that was it.
Is he all my white? He no color, dumb. He does no art. She gave him a smiley bonnet. It's not working, not on Loud my daddy loom the horror killing. Say a good trail like no liar than ya, but it's not yes, well, I guess it's got a queer rock. I can have won the seal.
And in regards to your own position within the group, you've often described yourself as the mortar between the bricks.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, well, they were a kind of rough and ready, disorganized bunch when I first met them and got together with them. And life was just an adventure and just a devil-may-care attitude and just live from day to day. But when there was a commercial element crept into it, and I became the most organized of a disorganized bunch, if you like, and kept things together and formed a certain structure for looking after money and stuff like that, you know. In the early days, whatever came in on the door was split up that night and everybody went home happy. And then after a while, when we were doing gigs down the country and there was a need for transport and hiring out, we used to hire out microphones for the weekly gigs. And then I suggested, well, should we not be putting some money aside and building up a kitty for expenses and transport and, you know, that kind of thing. So I was involved in that kind of a setting up of some sort of a structure and opening bank accounts and keeping some semblance of order and things. So I described myself one time as the mortar between the bricks, you know, keeping things together, keeping the building standing.
Well, we're glad that you did.
Yeah.
I'd say it was some task.
Yeah.
Would the Dubliners have been around the Clancy brothers much?
We used to meet them and have sessions in O'Donoghue's pub in Dublin when they were home on holidays from America, you know, to come home nearly every summer. So we're all good friends. There was no real rivalry there. People imagined there was a rivalry between us and the Clancy, but there wasn't, and there was no need for it anyway. You know, the cake was big enough for everybody to have a slice of, you know.
If my true love she were gone, I would surely find another, where wild mountain thyme grows around
we'll all go together to pluck wild mountain tide. All around the blooming heather will you go.
Well, obviously, alcohol played a huge role in the group and the culture that the group came up through, but most members of the Dubliners, they quit the drink at one point or another, right?
They did at various times, yeah. And Ronnie gave it up a few times, went on the dry for a couple of years and back on it again. Mm. His last few years, I don't think he was drinking very much at all, but people talk about the drink and was that was that injurious to the health? It's hard to say. I mean, Ciarán, anybody could get a brain aneurysm, and Luke died from a tumor in the brain. Mm. I don't know if you can necessarily attribute that to excessive drinking or not, but fair bit of drinking done, all right, but it was exaggerated a bit as well, you know.
I guess it became a part of the marketing in some ways too, right?
Yeah, it became a marketing tool, I suppose, especially after Seven Drunken Nights and the imagery there and press photographs taken with everybody swilling pints and that kind of thing, you know.
And drinking and partying is one thing, but once it becomes expected of you, that's a whole other thing really, isn't it?
Yeah, that's right. The people like the image, but at the same time, if you were drunk on stage, they wouldn't be too pleased, you know.
I must wander. Where are me boots? Me noggin boots. They're all sold for beer and tobacco. See the soles, they were thin, and the uppers were letting in, and the heels were looking out for better weather. And it's all for me grub, me jolly, jolly grub. All for my beer and tobacco. Well, I spent all me tin, but the lassies drinking gin. Far across the Western Ocean I must wander. Where is me shirt, me noggin, noggin shirt? It's all sold for beer and tobacco. You see the sleeves, they were worn out, and the collar being turned about, and the tail was looking out for better weather. And it's all for me grub, me jolly, jolly grub. All for my beer and tobacco. Well, I spent all me tin with the lassies drinking gin. For across the Western Ocean I must wander.
And Luke Kelly, I mean, what a unique singer and spirit. He brought so much soul to the songs.
Yeah. Luke had his own way of putting a stamp on a song, I think. Anything he's recorded, it became, for a lot of people afterwards, the definitive version of a song, you know, like songs like Raglan Road and The Town Loves So Well and some of these Dirty Old Towns, some of these great songs. Mm-hmm. I think he was just gifted with a natural way of phrasing a song as much as the quality in his voice, you know. Mm. Sometimes he'd stretch out a note at the end of a line and create a certain tension between himself and the audience and left you a little bit worried that he wasn't going to make it into the next line of time. But somehow he always had that compensation built into his phrasing that was one of the characteristics. Actually, I wrote a short poem about that called The Long Note. Will I give you that one?
Please do. Please do, John.
Yeah, just trying to describe that particular gift. You were the one for the phrasing, Luke. I loved the way you played hide and seek with the pulse of a song, stretching a note beyond the bar line till you left us dangling at a cliff edge. With a thread about to snap, you rescued the rhythm and reeled us in to catch a missing heartbeat.
On Raglan Road, of an autumn day, I saw her first and knew that her dark hair that I might one day rue.
I saw the danger and I passed along the enchanted way, and I said, let me be a fallen leaf at the dawn.
But Luke had no value on monetary things really, or physical things. He was a kind of a free spirit, and just as an example of his generosity, I was in his house one day, and I saw a piece of furniture I hadn't seen before. It was this black octagonal table inlaid with gold fluting around the edges. And I said, that table there, Luke, that's amazing. I haven't seen that before. He said, Deirdre bought that at an auction last week. And I said, God, well, that's some coincidence, because my wife, Mary, she bought a set of chairs to the exact match of that table. And partly in jest, I said to him, either you'll have to take my chairs or I'll have to take your table and complete the set. They obviously got split up in some auction. So without any hesitation, he said, do you fancy the table? I said, oh, it's beautiful. He said, right. And he had me pushed out the door with the table between us and onto the roof rack of my car. He said, there's the table for you. And that was the end of it.
Sure, we'd like your daddy here. Yes, sure, it would be fine to have him working near our home and to see him all the time. But beggars can't be choosers, and we have to bear our load, for we need the money your daddy earns out working on the road. Remember, laddie, he's still your dad, and he'll soon be home to stay for a week or two with me and you when he's built a motorway.
I was talking to an RTE guy one time about the difficulty of writing sonnets, and he compared it to trying to do a ballet dance in a straitjacket. I give you this one, sonnet for Luke. A fiery halo crowns your lived-in face. You shine forth like a beacon from the throng. Among your fellow peers, you set the pace and hush the gathered crowd with your song. Committed to the cause of human rights, you hold aloft the flame of amnesty. When striking workers seek you in their plight, you rally to their cause unstintingly. A minstrel boy, you charm your way through life, enriching all who chance to pass your way. You shelter wayward spirits from the night and keep them plied with drink till dawn of day. Though links with us, alas, too soon are severed, your spirit and your song will live forever.
City fair rode I. There are mad lines of marching men in squadrons passed me by. No fife did hum nor battle drum did sound its dread tattoo, but the Angelus bells o'er the Liffey swell rang out.
through the foggy dew. Ride proudly high over Dublin town, they hung out the flag of war. 'Twas better to die 'neath an Irish sky than at Sulva or Sudalbar. And from the plains of Royal Meath, strong men came hurrying through, while Britannia's Huns with their long-range guns sailed in through the foggy...
And we're all great characters, amazing. I mean, such a diverse collection of people you couldn't imagine ever putting together and working as a group. But somehow when we got on stage and played together, I know it's an old cliche, but we became more than the sum of the parts. Something magical happened between us, you know.
In Alabama, 1958, the cost of human life is very low. A man that flag is trampled down just like when we're 1,000 years ago. But these are more enlightened days, no room for all these savage ways. Leave them, let them go. Now every man may walk his road in peace, for all are free. 2,000 years ago, 1 million men were gathered into Royal Egypt's land. We're bound together, forced to build pyramids of stone and desert sands. But these are more enlightened days, no room for all these savage ways. Leave them, let them go. Now every man may walk his road in peace, for all are free. Mary's son walks through a land of woe, dreaming of the world as it could be. But the good and lawful men of Rome bound him like a rubber to a tree. But these are more enlightened days, no room for all these savage ways. Leave them, let them go. Now every man may walk his road in peace, for all are free.
While we're on the subject of the strength of the individual members of the group, Ronnie Drew, he's kind of seen to represent Dublin's core, but he was born in Dunleary and he lived out in Greystones in County Wicklow, didn't he?
That's right, yeah. Yeah, people used to slag him about that sometimes, saying, you're not a proper Dubliner at all, you're out in Dunleary, County Dublin. And as you say, he ended up in Greystones. That's where he ended up living most of his life after. He used to live in Waterloo Road in the early years for a couple of years. Mm-hmm. And Ronnie was very much perceived, I think, as the father figure of the group.
My town. Ring a ring, the rosy. As the light declines, I remember Dublin City in the rare old times. Fare thee well, sweet Anna Liffey, I can no longer stay and watch the new glass cages that spring up along the quay. My mind's too full of memories, too old to hear new chimes. I'm a part of what was Dublin in the rare old times. Ring a rosy, as the light declines, I remember Dublin City in the rare old times. Ring a rosy, as the light declines, I remember Dublin City in the rare old times.
I've often heard it said that he didn't really deal in sentimentality. What would your interpretation of that be?
Yeah, very much. He hated hypocrisy and that kind of thing. And that could be another poem, actually. I think I captured a few bits and pieces of Ronnie. I called it a sketch of a Dubliner. Sketch of a Dubliner. I'll give you this one, sure. Might be an easier way of answering the question.
Absolutely.
Need a poem. Sketch of a Dubliner. Bearded bass boom, slim-lined, short-fused, razor-sharp. Center stage holding forth. Center bar toasting life. Purveyor of street ballad, crafter of storyline, disciple of Zosimus flirting with fame. Imbiber of the black stuff, epicenter of the crack, master of retort, outwitting the heckler. Jovial raconteur conjuring with words, precision timing, knockout punchline. Grumpy at morning, barbed wire, vinegar. Convivial at evening, rose without thorns. Champion of the underdog, dethroning the haughty. Sounding uncomfortable truths, uplifting the needy. Disenchanted, weary of applause, wary of patronage, impatient for the encore. Distillation of the Liffey, salt of the earth, Dublin personified, Ronnie Drew.
That paints the picture of a solid character.
Yeah.
He didn't stand much messing about, did he?
No. He'd cut the ground from under you very quickly. If you had a totally opposing view.
Oh, the first of me downfall, I set out the door. I straight made me way on for Caddycon shore. Going out be rattle-roning to us late in the night. Going out the west gate for to view the gas light. Raddly fall, the diddle I, raddly fall, the diddle there, oh. I went to the tousle to see the big lamp. And who should I meet but a bloody big tramp? I kindly stepped over, and to him I said, will you kindly direct me to where I'll get a bed? Raddly fall, the diddle I, raddly fall, the diddle there, oh. T'was then he directed me down to Cook's Lane, to where old Buck's engine cap and old sleeping cage. Hung out o' the door was a small piece of board, hung out on two nails with a short piece of cord. Raddly fall, the diddle I, raddly fall, the diddle there, oh.
Yeah, the only for meeting that girl in Germany, I probably never thought of writing poetry. It's
only for
thing.
She was good looking.
Oh, yes. If she hadn't been so good looking, I mightn't have gotten into the poetry.
There's two things I wanted to hit on before we finish up.
The
monumental occasion of linking up with the Pogues. I guess Eamon Campbell, a later addition to the Dubliners, was partly responsible for that.
That's right, yeah. We'd known Eamon for years and years. He was one of the guys around town, great record producer, brilliant guitar player. And he used to play with a band called the Dermot O'Brien. Dermot O'Brien was a club man.
And I wonder, will she think of me when she hears them cannons roar? Ah, but when the war is over, and when dear old Ireland is free, I will take her to the church to wed, and the rebel's wife she'll be. So we're off to Dublin in the green, in the green, where the helmets listen in the sun, where the bayonets flash and the rifles crash to the echo of the
town. But he produced a lot of records for Irish singers over the years, and when it came to doing our 25-year album, we got Eamon on board to produce it. And one of the ideas he came up with was to do a song with the Pogues.
Mm.
Now, he assumed in the beginning that we didn't know much about the Pogues, but we had met them a number of years before in Austria at a folk festival in Austria, and we got on great with them, and it reminded us with the energy and the rawness of the whole thing, very much like ourselves 25 years earlier. And so there was a great empathy between us. And so when it came to, as I say, we had a number of guests on our 25 year album, and Eamon taught the Pogues. We should think about recording a song with the Pogues. So we just phoned them up and they said, right, come on over. We're in the studio at the moment recording some stuff. And was it Ronnie or Eamon? Somebody came up with the idea of the Irish Rover, anyway, as a duet between Ronnie and Shane. And the whole thing was done very casually. We arrived over on a morning flight, Eamon and Ronnie and myself, and got into the studio and ran the song a couple of times, said, right, let's go for a record. And the whole thing was done in 3 or 4 hours from start to finish. Brought it back to Dublin and added on Barney's banjo. And that was about it, really. It didn't need too much dressing up. The feel was there in the take, you know.
Especially over from London to join with us and pay tribute to the Dubliners. Here's a number from the Dubs with the Pogues.
We set sail from the sweet cove of Cork. We were sailing away with the cargo of bricks for the Grand City Hall in New York. But a wonderful craft, she was rigged for the daft, and now howled a wild wind over. She stood several blasts, she had 27 masts, and they called her the Irish Rover.
Bikes of the best layer ranks. We had 2 million barrels of fun. We had 3 million barrels of our nanny got sales. We had 4 million barrels of stone. We had 5 million dogs, 6 million huts, 7 million barrels of porns. We had 8 million hides of our blind horses' hides. And all of the Irish Rover.
There was our Mickey Coote, who played hard.
And that created quite a bit of a sensation here in Ireland. And we were back on Top of the Pops again 20 years after our first venture on Top of the Pops with Seven Drunken Nights.
I guess one of the main differences was having the drums.
Yes, that would have been the drums and the bass, I suppose. Yeah, that gave it an extra bit of a lift. Yeah, we never had drums in the Dubliners. And there was great energy in the way they played and performed, you know. And I think it was captured in the take. It really comes across. But created a bit of a sensation. People really sat up and took notice and said, God, the boys are back in town.
Yeah. That must have felt good.
I did, yeah. It was a great, great feeling after 20 years. I remember back in Top of the Pops again. I remember there was a young studio assistant there, and he approached Ronnie and said, Ronnie, would you like me to show you around the studio? Remember Ronnie's reply, he said, listen, son, I was here before you were born. Yeah.
All that the grasses grow and the waters flow in a free and easy way, but give me enough of the rare old stuff that's made near Galway Bay. Come gougers all from Donegal, Sligo and Leitrim too, and we'll give them the slip and we'll take a sip of the Rayla and Mountain Dew.
Skiddly idle little dumps, skiddly idle little dumps, skiddly yum a title little dumps, aye. Skiddly idle little dumps, skiddly idle little dumps, skiddly yum a title little dumps, aye.
There's a night little still at the foot of the hill where the smoke curtains up in the sky. Be a whiff of the smell, you can plainly tell that there's witching boys close by. Where it fills the air with a perfume rare to be fixed both me and you. As home we roll, we'll drink a bowl on a bucket full of Mountain Dew.
Skiddly idle little dumps, skiddly idle little dumps, skiddly yum a title little dumps, aye. Skiddly idle little dumps, skiddly idle little dumps, skiddly yum a title little dumps, aye. Rice and Ireland, by this year's the pile, they've written your prizes high. The sweet pachane from Ireland, drink the smite from Gwaed and Rye. Go away with your pills, it'll cure all ills, for a pagan Christian or Jew.
Take off your coat and grace your throat with a bucket full of Mountain Dew.
Silly idle diddle dum, silly idle diddle dum, silly I'm a diddle diddle dum day. Silly idle diddle dum, silly idle diddle dum, silly I'm a diddle diddle dum day.
The band loosely formed around 1962. Fast forward 50 years, 2012. You just called it a day?
Yeah, well, with everybody gone, just Barney myself often talked, it's time to pack it up. And I'd say, when do you want to finish? Ah, well, we could do the odd festival. He didn't really want to stop. But when the 50th year was approaching in 2012, we had a chat and we thought, maybe this is the time, you know, you could go on forever, you could go on till we all drop dead. And there comes a point at which you shouldn't force something to continue beyond a certain point, even if it's commercially okay or successful to do so. So we'd agreed on that, Barney, myself. Little did we think that he wouldn't finish out the 50th year himself. He died in April of that year, 2012.
Oh, me name is Jock Stewart. I'm a canny gang man and a roving young fellow I've been.
So we 80 and 3. When you're drinking with me, I'm a man you don't meet every day.
So then when it came to the end of the year, the rest of the lads, Eamon and Sean, wanted to continue on, but I thought the name was too important for it to be continued on, and maybe changes of personnel and, you know, all sorts of changes would distort the original memory of the group. So they continued on for a while, calling themselves the Dublin Legends. Yeah, Dublin Legends, I think. Anyway, the group was wrapped up officially wrapped up at the end of 2012. 50 years, it was a fitting point at which to put a line under it, I think.
Of all the money that ever I had, I spent it in good company, and of all the harm that ever I done, alas, it was to none but me. And all I've done for want of wit, to memory now I can't recall. So fill to me the parting glass, good night and joy be with you all. Of all the friends that ever I had, they are sorry at my going away. And of all the sweethearts that ever I had, they would wish me one more day to stay. But since it falls until my lot that I should rise and you should not, I softly rise and I gently call, good night and joy be with you all.
And through those years, alongside the Dubliners, you recorded and performed with a lot of different people, didn't you?
Yeah, I played on different people's records over the years. Back in the 80s sometime, I played on a Kate Bush album called The Hounds of Love. She came to Dublin to record a few of her songs, and she got Bill Whelan to produce them. she had Irish connections, of course. Her mother came from Waterford, I think. So anyway, Bill asked me would I come in and play the fiddle on a couple of tracks. I'd played for Bill a few. Bill and ourselves went back a long time. He produced some of the earlier Dublin albums as well. But Kate Bush, she was a joy to play with, a big gorgeous girl. And I remember Bill, she had stayed in Bill's house, I think, the night before, and Bill had written a bit of a jig for this particular song that he wanted to incorporate in this instrumental piece on, what was it called? The Jig of Life, actually, I think was the name of the track on her Hounds of Love album.
Hello, old lady, I know your face well. I know it well, she says, na 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 na. Be sitting in your mirror and now is the place where the crossroads meet. When you look into the future, never, never say goodbye.
But I remember, it was funny in the studio, I was trying out the jig and Kate was standing beside me. And suddenly I saw a tear coming into her eye and streaming down her face. And I stopped and said, anything wrong, Kate? And she said, oh, your playing is so emotional. And I said, oh, thanks. And I gave her a big hug. And here's Bill looking out the control room window. He's only after he introduced me to this board, and he's looking out, and there the two of them having a hug and a kiss and wondering what the hell is going on here. But she's a lovely girl. I played on a couple of tracks on that album. And we became friends. We used to exchange Christmas cards. And I remember I was doing paper folding at the time, you know, that Japanese paper folding origami.
Yeah, yeah.
And I made a few models of origami for her in the studio, just messing around on a plain paper. But that Christmas, she sent me a Christmas card and a little pack of official origami paper, you know, stuff like that.
Since we're coming to the end here, would I be pushing my luck to ask for another tune on the tin whistle there, John?
Ah, yeah. Yeah, I'll play this piece called St. Patrick's Cathedral. Got the inspiration after visiting St. Patrick's Cathedral in Dublin here. And got the idea of trying to, you get this special feeling in these old medieval buildings sometimes. And it's just an idea to try and translate some of that feeling into a melody. Da, 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 da. Oh, yeah.
Thank you.
It's an honor to see you playing that way and have a private show here. I know we were just dissing the online stuff, but that's different, you know.
yeah.
This is going to wrap up in a couple of minutes, so thanks very much for taking your time here with me. It's much appreciated.
Not at all, Dylan. Pleasant having a chat. It was nice and casual and natural.
Ah, good.
Yeah, I heard a bit of your, I didn't listen to the whole thing yet, your rambling Jack Elliott one.
Oh, really?
That was good. I met him a couple of times in Denmark at a festival there, Thunder Festival or Tuner Festival, as they call it. Yeah, a real character.
Did you chat with him much, yeah?
He was part of a crowd, and not really, we didn't really get to know each other, but everybody was around him.
When you're teetotal, you always get a rotten feeling that everybody is a boss. People, you don't realize yet that I stand before you as the room is limited. The representative of the man that made the country what it is today, the working man. I have been deputed. Not only deputed, but asked to speak on behalf of the working man. What about these blooming capitalists, millionaires, the people with the money? What do they do on a Saturday night when they see a poor working fella going home just a wee bit drunk? Ah, they condemn him. They do. They point the stinger of foreign at him. Look at that common labourer under the affluence of alcohol. Disgraceful. Oh, what does this poor fella got to do? Isn't he got to get home? What about the rich people themselves? Why, they got big, fast motor cars. They can go past so quick you don't know whether they're drunk or sober. But I know. I know because they're Glasgow. Dear old Glasgow too. But there's something up my head with Glasgow.
I mean, this stuff for me too, as an artist, it's been a difficult time for me. It hasn't been that creative. So getting you guys on here and talking to you guys is just kind of reminding me of why I do what I do too, you know?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. I know you got a big accolade from Christy Moore right there. And that's something to be proud of.
Well, I appreciate you saying so.
Yeah. Can I give you one final poem? Unstable. My internet connection is unstable. It's gone again.
Yeah, it got a bit glitchy there. It's because you were complimenting me.
You're gone unstable.
Yeah.
the last poem in my book, it's called Signatures, and it's based on the notion that we all leave our signature on the world and hopefully leave it a better place than the world we came into. And we all do it in different ways, but the musician does it in a slightly different way to everybody else. That's the notion of this. Because the ploughman leaves his trace on field and furrow. The sculptor's mark is etched in chiseled stone. With sheaves of gold, the thatcher's name is written. In rings of clay, the potter's name is known. When day is done, an evening firelight beckons. When tradesmen all are free from toil and care, I linger in the shadows with my fiddle and softly leave my signature in air.
I think that's a beautiful way to end this chat, John.
Yeah, we leave it all up in the air.
Again, thanks so much for being here, John.
Yeah, no problem. A pleasure. And sure, if you're ever over in Dublin, whenever you're over, when all this madness lockdown is finished, you can meet up and have a chat or a pint or a cup of coffee or a cup of tea.
Just no music.
Or a tune, yeah.
All right, sure. I'll be in touch.
Okay, don't forget to send me your address, and we'll keep in touch.
Absolutely. Talk to you soon, John.
Okay. God bless. See you then.
In 1841, me corduroy breeches I put on. Me corduroy breeches I put on. To work upon the railway, I'm weary of the railway, poor Paddy works on the railway. In 1842, from Hartlepool I moved to Crewe, and I found myself a job to do, working on the railway. I was wearing corduroy breeches, digging ditches, pulling switches, dodging hitches. I was working on the railway. In 1843, I broke my shovel across my knee, and I went to work for the company on the Leeds and Selby Railway. I was wearing corduroy breeches, digging ditches, pulling switches, dodging hitches. I was working on the railway. In 1844, I landed on the